You are probably wondering why I'm here, and I'll explain it to you. We're a duet. and after he's done preaching, we're going to sing a few songs for you. But he doesn't play the guitar. He plays the harmonica, and he couldn't bring the harmonica with, so he'll be singing on it. Okay, the real reason why I'm here is because Hammond decided that for the sake of keeping people safe from the virus, they were not going to have service tonight. I guess we're not having it on Sunday.
Until further notice.
Which means that he's a free agent now. So I'm watching him carefully just in case I find a new hall in front of my house. Anyway, it's good to have you here, Craig. And Pastor Craig's going to share with us a message today. And I am here just because I want to worship. And also because I figure I can play while I'm here. I busted my guitar, so I'm glad that Tom had his old guitar here, so thank Tom. And I'm waiting for the strings to come back, and then I'll restring my guitar and get it done. So what we're going to do is I'm going to run through a couple of announcements, and then we'll start our worship to the Lord. I want to remind you that if you are on the council of Lakeview, after this service, if you would stay just for a moment, we need to talk about what the plan is as far as worship on Sunday and further Lent services. I know that right now Trinity Bergen is also talking. They have not, as far as I know, made a decision yet about what to do, although there is a tendency towards maybe not having service on Sunday and waiting to see what the next week will bring. But at this point, I can't tell you what we're going to do because I don't know yet. But after service, please stay. Those of you who are in council, and let's visit about what you want to do. I do want to say also that each congregation is free to do as they see fit. So just because Trinity Bergen makes one decision doesn't mean you have to make one. If they decide to come back to service and you decide not to, that you're free to do that. If they decide to call off services for a couple weeks and you decide to keep doing it, then that's your prerogative and we will work through that and it will be just fine. So no one is forced to do anything, but it would be good just for everybody to know that we have made the decision how we're going to move forward given the fact that the coronavirus is out there. And everything we need to know is how we're going to operate. In the midst of that. All right, so that being said, are there any other announcements? Okay. I would like you, if you would, if you are not on my Facebook page, please feel free to get there because there will be other announcements that will come on. As I get them, I will put them out there for everybody to look at them. And I will certainly put it on the Sunday school page so that people are aware of what's going on there as well. All right. But again, just remember, nothing to be afraid of. Don't panic. The only reason that we're kind of checking on things is just to make sure that we're not spreading it to other people. Just taking due precaution. I still think, and this is my opinion, I still think it's the threat for us both. But that being said, it only takes one. So let's be wise because we're called to love our brothers and sisters. And sometimes loving our brothers and sisters means continuing worship. And the people who feel like they need to stay home and look at it on the computer, or maybe shutting down service for a couple weeks and having people isolate. Either one. We got to check, see what the Lord has in mind, but let's love one another as the Lord commands us to do. All right, with that in mind, we're going to sing our first hymn. It's 104, Looking for the Worship. So I'd like to please rise and sing that. That's the reason for that. Let's hit 104.
Seem out of control. And when they're not in control,
It's a frightening prospect because they don't know that you are in control. Lord, we acknowledge tonight that you are in control of all things. You're in control of the universe. You're in control of diseases, bacteria, viruses, whatever may come our way. And as plagues came from you or were stopped by you in the Old Testament, Lord, we just pray that you might work again, that you might use this illness, this virus, to your honor, Lord, in the life of the world, in the life of our country, in our lives. We pray that you might accomplish your will in it all. And we pray that you'll protect us tonight and always, that you might only let that come to us what you want to come. Just put a shield about us because we seek you tonight. Pray that you would come and with your spirit and your word, speak to our hearts whatever we need to hear. That the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. We ask this in the precious and powerful name of Jesus. Amen. On this Lenten season, we're looking at less-known witnesses to the Passion, and tonight we're going to look at Simon of Cyrene. And in Scripture, Simon of Cyrene came from the shadows of obscurity into the light. In theater terms, you might say that he was an onlooker to a play. He was standing off stage in the theater wings of obscurity, watching the play, when all of a sudden he was thrust onto the stage of eternal significance to play a part in the most important drama of all time, the execution of Jesus. I was trying to think of a contemporary similarity that's comparable to Simon's. Perhaps President Trump might be similar in that he stepped from political obscurity where no one knew for sure what he believed because he was a Democrat and became a Republican and just not sure where he stood on things. I think he's changed a lot over the years. But he stepped from that obscurity into political fame and whether you like it or not, he has become important to you and to me. Either for what he has accomplished in the office in a short time or for the bad reputation that his enemies have hung on him. But for whatever reason, he's become important to everyone. Before, we could just ignore him. He's just a rich guy. Well, Simon of Cyrene was just a bystander on Good Friday. He was a visitor to the city of Jerusalem, in from the country, for the Passover feast. And he happened to be standing in the streets when Jesus was being led to the execution at Calvary. I'm going to read the passage I forgot to read before. Nothing wrong with me except my memory. Matthew 27, beginning at the 24th verse. When Pilate saw that he was accomplishing nothing, but rather that a riot was starting, he took water and washed his hands in front of the crowd, saying, "I am innocent of this man's blood. See to that yourselves." And all the people said, "His blood shall be on us and on our children." Then he released Barabbas for them, but after having Jesus scourged, he handed him over to be crucified. And the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the praetorium and gathered the whole Roman cohort around him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him. And after twisting together a crown of thorns, they put it on his head and a reed in his right hand. And they knelt down before him and mocked him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews." They spat on him and took the reed and began to beat him on the head. After they had mocked him, they took the scarlet robe off him and put his own garments back on him and led him away to crucify him. As they were coming out, they found a man of Cyrene named Simon, whom they pressed into service to bear his cross. So he was taken into service by the soldiers to carry Jesus' cross. And I was thinking that I felt kind of like a bystander with regard to this coronavirus, because it seems to be far away. At least it hasn't been. But like Simon, we're all going to get involved. We're all going to be drawn into the effects of it in some way. It might be by the shortness of toilet paper or hand sanitizer, but also in other ways. It's interesting how everything is so interconnected. I have a daughter who's a pharmacist in Fargo, and she figures she's going to get sick sometime because of the people coming through there, although they're screening them and not letting them come into the pharmacy if they look sick at all. But she doesn't want to come to visit me because she might carry it to me. And my other daughter, who's a stay-at-home mom, she is concerned about her children, my grandchildren, because her husband is an IT guy at the St. Cloud Hospital, and he works in surgery, so he has to be there. He can't work at home, and sometime he might have to be quarantined at the hospital for a while. In some way, we're all going to be affected. But the interesting thing is that that day, Simon was just standing by there and got drawn into this drama. But the one who drew him in was Jesus. Jesus was passing by. In a sense, with this virus, Jesus is also passing by. And he can touch us or draw us into that virus situation if he wishes. And it will be for our good. It was for Simon's good that day. All we're told about him is that he carried Jesus' cross and his name and where he's from. Just one brief moment in his body. But he's important because he offered up the perfect sacrifice. And that perfect sacrifice had three parts. First of all, he came to offer an acceptable sacrifice for his sins. He came to offer an acceptable sacrifice for his sins. A Christian song by Greg Bowles from a few years ago entitled "Watch the Lamb" kind of sheds a different light on Simon for me. We might be tempted to think that from the gospel accounts that he was just a disinterested bystander that day, but I don't think so. Ray Bolts is just speculating, but he paints a picture of Simon and his two little sons coming to offer a lamb as sacrifice, and we don't have any idea what age they were or anything, or that they were all there together. But this is what he suggests. Walking on the road to Jerusalem, the time had come to sacrifice again, My twins saw it, and my two small sons, they walked side by side on the road. The reason that they came was to watch the lamb. Daddy, Daddy, what do we see there? There's so much that we don't understand. So I told them of Moses and Father Abraham, and I said, dear children, watch the lamb. There will be so many in Jerusalem today, we must be sure the lamb doesn't run away. And I told them of Moses and Father Abraham, and I said, dear children, watch the lamb. When we reached the city, I knew something must be wrong. There were no joyful worshipers, no joyful worship songs. I stood there with my children in the midst of angry men. Then I heard the crowd cry out, crucify him. We tried to leave the city, but we could not get away. Forced to play in this drama, a part I did not wish to play. Why upon this day were men condemned to die? Why were we standing here, where soon they would pass by? I looked and I said, even now they come. The first one cried for mercy, the people gave him none. The second one was violent, he was arrogant and loud. I still can hear his angry voice screaming at the crowd. And someone said, there's Jesus. I could scarce believe my eyes. A man so badly beaten, he barely looked alive. Blood poured from his body, from the thorns upon his brow. Running down the cross, falling to the ground. I watched him as he struggled. I watched him as he fell. The cross came down upon his back. The crowd began to yell. In that moment, I felt such agony. In that moment, I felt such loss. Till the Roman soldier grabbed my arm and screamed, you, carry the cross. At first, I tried to resist him. Then his hand reached for his sword. So I knelt and took the cross from the Lord. I placed it on my shoulder and started down the street. The blood that he'd been shedding was running down my cheek. They led us to Golgotha. They drove nails deep in his hands and feet. Yet upon the cross, I heard him cry, Father, forgive them. Oh, never have I seen such love in any other eyes. Into thy hands I commit my spirit, he prayed, and then he died. I stood for what seemed like years. He lost all sense of time until I felt two tiny hands holding tight to mine. My children stood there weeping. I heard the oldest say, Father, please forgive us. The lamb ran away. Daddy, Daddy, what have we seen here? There's so much that we don't understand. So I took them in my arms and we turned and faced the cross. Then I said, dear children, watch the lamb. I think that song's not far off track. We know that Simon was not a native-born Israelite. He was from Cyrene, a city in Libya in North Africa. And probably he was a proselyte, someone who had won into the Jewish faith. He had to have come to Jerusalem on that important feast day because he believed in the true God of Scripture. He probably came to offer a sacrifice for his sins, as God's law and Scripture required. I believe he knew his need for a sacrifice for his sins. We know our need. Romans 3:23 says, for all our sin we come short of the glory of God. And Romans 6:23 says, for the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. We've all sinned. The wages of sin is death. And Hebrews 9:22 says, without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins. Simon expected the lamb to pay for his sins. Whose blood will pay for your sins. Your blood or Jesus' blood, that's the only other choice. Secondly, not only did he come to offer a acceptable sacrifice for his sins, but instead, he carried the altar on which Jesus was sacrificed. Animal sacrifices were offered on an altar, the altar at the temple. But Jesus' altar was the cross. In John 19, a parallel passage to this one in Matthew, it says, they took Jesus, therefore, and they went out bearing his own cross to the place called the place of the skull, which is called in Hebrew Golgotha. So he went out carrying his own cross at the beginning, but he was too weak or tired after that long night without sleep and the false trial. And then be whipped and beaten in order to continue. He probably stumbled and fell into that heavy weight of the cross, and probably right next to where Simon was standing. In Luke 23, the parallel passage there, we read, when they led him astray, they seized a man, Simon of Cyrene, coming in from the country, and placed on him the cross to carry behind Jesus. So they placed this cross from Jesus, the altar on which Jesus was to be sacrificed, on Simon's shoulders. And so, in a sense, Simon offered up Jesus as a sacrifice that day by carrying that altar on which he was going to be sacrificed. We're told in Galatians 3:13, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree. There was a curse on those who would hang on a tree, who would hang on a cross. And Jesus was cursed not for his own sin, but he was cursed because he bore the curse for us. But Simon carried that altar in which Jesus was sacrificed. Then thirdly, the sacrifice of Jesus covered everyone. The sacrifice of Jesus covered everyone. Simon intended to offer a sacrifice which would at the most cover him and his family. But in Hebrews 10:12, we're told that the sacrifice that he ended up offering in Jesus covered everything. In the 12th verse it says, but he, Jesus, having offered one sacrifice for sins for all time, sat down at the right hand of God. So Jesus' sacrifice covered everyone for all time. We know that it covered Simon and his sons, first of all, because they became believers. They were well known to the followers of Christ. Otherwise, you wouldn't know their names. In Mark 15, the parallel passage there, it says in verse 21, they pressed into service a passerby coming from the country, Simon of Cyrene, parentheses, the father of Alexander and Rufus, to bear his cross. There's no way that they would have known who those people were if they hadn't known him later as part of their fellowship. Peter was the one who was telling Mark what to write. Peter knew these people. Jesus' sacrifice was perfect, not only because it covered all time, but it covered all people. It covered all people before Simon and after Simon's time. In Hebrews 7, we read in the 26th verse, "For it was fitting for us to have such a high priest, holy, innocent, undefiled, separated from sinners and exalted above the heavens, who does not need daily, like those high priests, to offer up sacrifices, first for his own sins, and then for the sins of the people. Because this he did once for all, when he offered up himself." Jesus' sacrifice was perfect because it covered everyone, including you and me. Simon of Cyrene offered up the perfect sacrifice that day. He started off to offer just an ordinary sacrifice, but one that was acceptable, according to Scripture, for himself and his sons. But instead he carried the altar on which Jesus was offered, the cross. And Jesus' sacrifice was perfect because it covered Simon and his family and everyone else. It covers you. It covers me. So we pray. Dear Lord Jesus, we thank you so much for that day when you bore our sins and you took our suffering and you died for us. Thank you for offering up yourself on the altar of the cross. And thank you for looking in Simon's life and calling him to your sacrifice, that he came to believe in you and have a part in your eternity. We pray that you'll help us to offer you up as our sacrifice today. Nothing else. Not our good works, not our goodness, not anything other than yourself. Help us to offer up you and your blood today as the only thing which will cover us and our mistakes and our sins and our inadequacies and everything about us that's not right. Lord, we pray that you will cover us with your blood, your sacrifice today, that we might live in your grace, in your freedom. Thank you, Jesus, for what you've done. In your name we pray.
Thank you. neighbor and friend. Who would have thought that a Lamb would rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. Counselor, comforter, keeper, Spirit we long to embrace. You offer open our hearts and hopelessly lost the way. Oh, we hopelessly lost the way. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace. Our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. Almighty and Father, faithfully loving your own, here in our weakness you find us, falling before your throne. Oh, we're falling before your throne. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for.
All right, we'll now receive the offering.
Pray
for all those who are in the corner. So we pray, Lord, your salvation and wisdom to come to our president, the vice president, the Senate, House, Supreme Court, our governors, state legislatures, state, local, and federal officials and judges. Where they're right, sustain them, and where they're wrong, grant them a spirit of grace and supplication to recognize the wrong, to mourn over their sins for the Lord's Son, to throw all their infamous decrees into the fire and be burned up forever, and to establish policies that are pleasing in your sight, and for the furtherance of your kingdom, and raise up righteous men and women, who would rule not according to the flesh, but according to your spirit and your word. We pray, Lord, especially now, during this time of the coronavirus, that you would give to our leadership and to our communities the wisdom and the knowledge that comes from you, so that, Lord, we would walk in the way that leads to righteousness and health and life, and that we would be a blessing to others, revealing your love and your salvation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Lord Jesus, you are the healer, and by your stripes we're healed. Thank you for that. Thank you that you purchased perfect healing for us on the cross of Calvary. And Lord, we come to ask that the healing of blood would fall upon each and every one of us, our family, our communities, and upon all those we mention now, whether out loud or in our hearts.
Lord, I just want to give you thanks. Our daughter Kate is doing better, much better. And she was tested for the coronavirus. It came back negative, so praise God.
Amen.
And Lord, I also want to pray for Bobby Uvey. This is Bland Grove's daughter. She'd had cancer 8 years ago, was over it, but she's got it again now in several different areas. Her body and her family has asked for prayer for her. And so we come to you, Jesus, for your healing for her.
Yes. Lord, we pray that you continue to help and strength from poor Andy Olson. And Lord, there is a lady with the type films who is now possibly someone infected with the coronavirus, and they're not sure. But we just pray the healing would be purchased on Calvary's Hill to come into her life that she would be saved. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Keep your hands, O Lord, we commend all of whom we pray. Trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
And as we are his disciples on earth, let us praise our Lord Jesus Christ for prayer.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
And now, Lord, bless you and keep you. Lord, make his face and shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you his peace. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Go in peace. Serve the crucified and risen Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We're going to sing our last hymn, and it's actually in the folder. We're going to sing Amazing Grace by James Brown. And before we do that, I want to do this one more thing because I forgot to do it. But Jeremy's going in back there with their family. And they have joined the church at Lakeview Lutheran. So let's give them a hand. All right, so sure we're joining that you got put on the council right away here.
What?
I said we're so sure you're joining that we put them on the council before you came.
Oh, yeah.
All right, well, God bless you guys. Welcome to the community. We are singing Amazing Grace by James Paul. Okay? That's in your folder.
take a rest like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy He rains. Unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me. His words, my hope, secures. He will my shield and portion be. As long as life endures, my chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, have ransomed me. And light of God, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains. Unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon, it is all like snow. The sun forbear to shine. But God, who called me here below, will be forever blind. He will be forever blind. You are forever blind.
All right, God bless you all. Be safe. Lights and